Hey, Doc, you better back up. We don't have enough road to get up to 88.
Roads? Where we're going, we don't need roads.
I am reviewing a YouTube video called Top 10 Worst Back to the Future Mistakes. The video is presented on YouTube by user Mattimation. In part 1, I responded to mistake number 10 listed in that video. In part 2, I will continue this discussion and will point out what is really wrong with the movie using the same section of the movie Mattimation used in his mistake number 10. There was one major flaw in Back to the Future Part 2, and Mattimation came close to finding it in his analysis.
But then Old Biff comes back to normal 2015? Alright, here's our mistake. If Old Biff changed the future in 1955, when he traveled back to the future, wouldn't he be traveling to the future he changed? Not the normal future Marty and Doc are currently in? There's even a line in the movie that explains why this doesn't work.
Right, so we go back to the future, and we stop Biff from stealing the time machine.
We can't, because if we travel into the future from this point in time, it will be the future of this reality.
Once Biff went back to 1955, a new timeline would immediately be created. However, it is an error to assume that the new timeline would be the Biff Pleasure Palace timeline, and to assume therefore that old Biff would then have had to return to the new Biff Pleasure Palace timeline when he went back to the future. I prepared a series of diagrams to show exactly what I'm talking about here. In the original timeline, Marty's family is nerdy. At the beginning of the movie, the timeline does not exist past 1985, because no one's future is written yet. We humans share a collective future that we create and shape with each choice and each interaction. Each choice and each interaction and each external factor has a potential future. Each choice we make can create a new future, so there are as many possible futures as there are choices and interactions. There's virtually no limit to the amount of timelines that can spring into the future from where we are at in the present. In Back to the Future, Marty gets into a time machine and accidentally goes back in time to the year 1955, where he interacts with his parents, interferes with them falling in love, and creates a new timeline in which they never marry and have kids. At least, that is what happens when someone goes back in time and makes a drastic change, according to Doc Brown in the second movie.
Obviously, the time continuum has been disrupted, creating this new temporal event sequence resulting in this alternate reality.
English, Doc.
Here. Let me illustrate. Imagine that this line represents time. Here's the present, 1985, the future, and the past. Prior to this point in time, somewhere in the past, the timeline skewed into this tangent, creating an alternate 1985. Alternate to you, me, and Einstein, but reality for everyone else.
According to Back to the Future 2, when someone goes back in time and changes things, they create a completely new alternate reality, complete with new versions of themselves.
You're supposed to be in Switzerland, you little son of a bitch!
Father, did you get kicked out of another boarding school?
At the end of the first movie, Marty goes back 10 minutes early and watches a second version of himself go back in time, the one who was raised by the cool parents. On his chalkboard in Back to the Future 2, Doc explains how changing something in the past creates a new branch or tangent that skews off of the old timeline. In order for these alternate timelines to contain alternate versions of yourself, this timeline would have to proceed like any other timeline because the future isn't written yet, which means the new timeline would have infinite possible futures and would be independent of the original timeline that was changed. In fact, the timeline Marty created when he changed his parents would be no different than any of the other possible futures from that particular moment in time, and would merely be one of the infinite futures that are possible at any moment in time. The altered timeline and the original timeline from which the person came who altered the timeline would have no effect on each other. And just as Biff created a new timeline where he is king of Hill Valley, and in so doing created another Marty who was in Switzerland in a boarding school in 1985 instead of time traveling, the Biff Marty encounters in Biff's pleasure palace is not the same Biff that went back in time to give himself a sports almanac. Just as the Marty who is in boarding school in Switzerland in the Biff timeline is not the same Marty who travels back with Doc Brown and who encounters Biff in the Biff reality. They are two different Martys who coexist in different parallel universes.
While we were in the future, Biff got the sports book, stole the time machine, went back in time, and gave the book to himself at some point in the past.
Yes, I got a little present for you. Something that'll make you rich.
The old Biff did not have a sports almanac and grew up washing cars. And that's not the Biff that the old Biff gave the book to. The Biff that the old Biff gave the book to in this scene is the original Biff before George McFly decks him. This Biff grows up and becomes George McFly's supervisor because this Biff has not yet gone to the dance and Marty's activities have not created the car washing Biff yet, the one who travels back to 1955. Marty McFly created this old Biff at the Enchantment Under the Sea dance when, in a twist of fate, George McFly ends up decking the Biff we now see receiving the book. When old Biff was decked by George McFly, he did not possess a sports almanac from 2015. When this new Biff gets decked, he will possess this almanac, so they are not the same Biff.
Give him a little bit of room, okay? A little bit of air. It's okay, I know CPR. I know CPR.
Hey. What's CPR?
You!
Fine.
Hey, did you just take his wallet?
There are now three distinct Biffs. Biff 1, who is never decked by George McFly and who grows up to be McFly's supervisor. Biff 2, who doesn't possess a sports almanac when he is decked and grows up a car washer.
Biff 1,
just finishing up the second coat now.
Now, Biff, don't con me.
This same Biff 2, the car washer, steals a time machine and goes back and gives Biff 1 a sports almanac from 2015, thus creating a third Biff who grows up one of the richest men in the world.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Biff Tannen Museum, dedicated to Hill Valley's number one citizen and America's greatest living folk hero, the one and only Biff Tannen.
But what happened to Biff 1, the one who was never decked by George? Does he disappear when Biff 2 is created? Not at all. For if he did vanish, it would mean his timeline vanished, in which case the movie's hero, Marty, would have also vanished. Why do I conclude that the only way for Biff 1 to have vanished when Biff 2 was created is if Biff 1's timeline itself was destroyed? Someone might argue, well, Marty McFly was vanishing in the first movie, but his timeline was not destroyed, only his existence in the timeline. And ironically, that argument is my real proof that when a new timeline is created, the people in the old timeline do not vanish. For you see, Marty began to vanish in the first movie, but it wasn't because the timeline he came from was vanishing. It was because he interfered with his parents' meeting, and thus, he was never born. But none of the events that created the second Biff, the one who grows up as a car washer, were in any way a threat to Biff's very existence. Those events only changed Biff's personality.
Are you deaf, McFly? Close the door and beat it.
No, Biff. You leave her alone.
And while a second Biff was created when Biff 1 was decked by George McFly, since Biff's existence was not threatened by this event, Biff 1 continued in existence, developing simultaneously with Biff 2. Because Marty McFly remembers Biff 1, the Biff who grew up as George's supervisor. How do I know Marty remembers Biff 1? When he gets back to the future, he mentions how Biff 1 wrecked the car.
Go to the lake.
Car's wrecked.
Wrecked? Wrecked? When the hell did this happen?
Why are you told? I'm sure the car's fine.
If the first Biff had vanished when George decked him, and the second Biff, the car washer, took over, then Marty would not remember the first Biff, nor would he remember that the first Biff wrecked the car, because the Biff who wrecked the car never existed at that point. Marty's remembrance of those events, and of a Biff who was never decked by George, is all the evidence we need that Marty has come from an alternate timeline that exists simultaneously with the new timeline he has created by meddling in the past.
1955.
We also know that when George McFly decked Biff, this created not just a new timeline, but a new Marty, one who was raised in a cool family with money rather than a poor, nerdy family. When old Biff goes back in time to give young Biff the book, he encounters Biff 1, not his younger self, but a Biff who has not yet been changed by being decked at the dance. When Biff 1 is given the book, he becomes Biff 3, who is also decked by George at the dance. But who takes a different path than Biff 2 by betting on a horse race in 1958 using an almanac from the future. Once Biff is given the book, Biff 3, the one who will eventually rule Hill Valley, is created. Yet his future is not yet created just because he possesses the book. Remember, no one's future is written in advance. The future Biff who rules the world might already be created, but he doesn't create his Pleasure Palace future until he bets on the horse race.
Right here at Biff made his first million betting on a horse race in 1958.
Biff 2 gives Biff 1 the almanac and creates Biff 3. But Biff 2 goes back to the future before Biff 3 creates his Pleasure Palace future by betting on sporting events. Old Biff returns to the future that he came from because the new future he planned to create was not yet created when he went forward in time. Mattimation suggests that he would have gone to the Pleasure Palace reality, and he's wrong.
Alright, here's our mistake. If old Biff changed the future in 1955, when he traveled back to the future, wouldn't he be traveling to the future he changed? Not the normal future Marty and Doc are currently in?
The answer to that question, Mattimation, is no, he would not. Yet that was not the most erroneous thing Mattimation said in his mistake number 10. Mattimation suggests that a deleted scene which shows old Biff vanishing after coming back to the future would sort of explain this inconsistency.
Now I put this low on the list because there's a deleted scene on the DVD that sort of explains it. It shows old Biff in the normal future walking in pain, and then it disappears. That sort of explains it, so I'll let this one slide.
The vanishing old Biff sequence that was deleted for a good reason. Not only does it not explain anything, it creates a huge plot hole. If old Biff vanished from existence after giving young Biff an almanac, that would mean that young Biff destroyed old Biff's timeline. If this makes sense, then it would also make sense that Marty and Doc should have vanished too. And what's more, so should the almanac that old Biff gave to young Biff likewise have vanished. If old Biff disappears when he gives young Biff the book, then we have a temporal causality loop. Marty buys a sports almanac in 2015. Old Biff steals it, steals the time machine, and goes back to 1955 to give it to himself. Old Biff gives young Biff the almanac in 1955 and destroys his own timeline. Old Biff vanishes. In which case, what is young Biff going to use to make his fortune? Old Biff vanishing doesn't explain anything. It cancels out his giving young Biff the book in the first place. Because old Biff's timeline vanishes, Marty and Doc also vanish. And if Marty vanishes, so does the almanac, because Marty is the one who bought it. Which in turn means the Biff Pleasure Palace reality is never created. It vanishes instantly when old Biff does, which means that old Biff exists again and is free to take the almanac to the past, where he then gives out the book, which then causes old Biff with the book to vanish again. The almanac vanishes with old Biff's timeline. Young Biff is never given the almanac. The future then unfolds as it did before. Marty buys an almanac, Biff steals it, and goes back in time. Old Biff then gives young Biff the book and erases himself again. This loop repeats itself over and over and over again. 1955, young Biff gets the book. 2015, old Biff disappears. Old Biff never travels back to give young Biff the book. Because he's never given an almanac, and because he never grew up as time-traveling old Biff, young Biff grows up as he did before, becoming old Biff who steals a time machine. Once again, old Biff gives young Biff the book. Young Biff with the book destroys old Biff with the book, which destroys time travel with the book, which destroys young Biff with the book. Young Biff with the book destroys old Biff with the book, which creates time travel with the book, which creates young Biff with the book. No old Biff with the book, no young Biff with the book. Temporal causality loop. The real error that Mattimation should have identified in his mistake number 10 is that since old Biff created a new reality when he used the almanac, complete with a new Marty and a new Doc Brown, when Doc and Marty and Jennifer go back to 1985 from 2015, they would never have gone back to the reality that young Biff created with the book, because that is a separate timeline and reality. The timeline Biff created with his time travel would be disconnected from the timeline they came from and would never affect them. If it did affect them, they would no longer exist, for the Biff who bet on sports games using the almanac would have destroyed them and their reality. The movie keeps employing two different contradictory theories to time travel. One, that when you go back and change the past, it overwrites the future, which overwrites what happens to you, which of course would only result in a temporal causality loop, as we have now demonstrated. And two, that when you change the past, you create an alternate reality complete with another you who lived a completely different life. Forgetting that such a new reality would have no effect upon you. If it did, then there would not be another you, but instead you would become whatever you this reality produced, and you would have no recollection of the original you.
Doc, we're not going back now.
Yep.
Doc, what about Jennifer? What about Einstein? We can't just leave them here.
Don't worry, Marty. Assuming we succeed in our mission, this alternate 1985 will be changed back into the real 1985, instantaneously transforming around Jennifer and Einie. Jennifer and Einie will be fine, and they will have absolutely no memory of this horrible place.
So there's really only one major mistake in all three Back to the Future movies. That being that they can't make up their minds how time travel works, and instead of having the plot fit how time travel works, they switch how it works at whim in order to fit the plot. The myriad of mistakes made in the Back to the Future series are really only one mistake, made over and over again in all three movies. Such as when they leave Jennifer and Einstein in the Biff Pleasure Palace timeline, Doc erroneously concludes that when they succeed in stopping young Biff from using the book, then the Biff Pleasure Palace timeline would revert back to the original 1985 timeline that they had left at the beginning of the movie.
Doc, what if we don't succeed?
We must succeed.
But if the new Biff Pleasure Palace timeline had any connection with their timeline, then, as I said before, they would have all ceased to exist once Biff created the timeline. We know that they are two different realities because there's another Marty there in Switzerland, and there's another Doc Brown in an insane asylum. When they succeed in stopping young Biff from using the book by taking it from him, they would have no effect on the timeline they had originally come from. They would also not have destroyed the Biff Pleasure Palace timeline where they left Jennifer and Einstein. It would have continued on just as one more alternate reality, and Jennifer and Einstein would have been trapped in that timeline forever.
Holy shit, you see?
By Doc's own explanation, when they go back to 1955 to take the almanac from young Biff, they would not be preventing the new timeline that old Biff created with his time travel.
In the future, Biff stopped the sports book, stole the time machine, went back in time, and gave the book to himself at some point in the past.
They would only be changing the past further, which would do nothing but create a new alternate reality.
Obviously, Ashley, the time continuum has been disrupted, creating this new temporal event sequence resulting in this alternate reality.
English, die.
The only way they could stop the Biff Pleasure Palace timeline from being created would be to somehow stop old Biff from going back in time. This is something, however, that Doc Brown rules out completely, and he's wrong. I can think of several ways they could accomplish this task.
It's the top of Biff's cane. I mean, old Biff from the future.
Correct. It was in the time machine because Biff was in the time machine.
Biff just sports overnight.
No. Our only chance to repair the present is in the past, at the point where the timeline skewed into this tangent.
If going back and taking the book from Biff would overwrite the future they just came from, which is their past, then the moment they take the book from young Biff, it would be as though he was never given the book in the first place.
Mr. McFly,
which would then create a causality loop and cause our characters to live in a Groundhog Day type of reality, reliving the same altering sequence of events over and over, only they would have no knowledge of the two realities.
All right.
At the moment Biff used the almanac to win $1 million, the almanac would disappear, for it would have never been purchased.
Of course, that was before they had us on paper.
And there would never have been an old Biff time traveler to bring it back to 1955, which in turn would eliminate the existence of billionaire Biff. As you can see, if creating a new timeline in the past upsets, overwrites, erases, or destroys the original timeline, then whenever you time travel to the past and change anything at all, you would upset, overwrite, erase, or destroy your own existence and result in you living alternate realities over and over again. And if you destroy your own existence, then you would never have existed, in which case you couldn't travel back in time and change anything, in which case the new timeline you created would then be destroyed as well. Once the new timeline is destroyed, you would then exist again and be able to someday go back in time, make changes, and create the new timeline again. Causality loop.
Oh, don't be so gullible, McFly.
If time travel worked in the way they presented in Back to the Future Part 2, then the changes you make in the past would instantly transform around you.
Alternate 1985 will be changed back into the real 1985, instantaneously transforming around Jennifer and Heidi.
Been asleep for almost 9 hours now.
So in Back to the Future 1, when Marty interfered with his parents falling in love, the new future would have instantly transformed around Marty, just like it did around Jennifer and Einstein.
Safe and sound now, back in good old 1955.
And Marty would have had no recollection of the previous timeline.
Jennifer and Einstein will be fine. They will have absolutely no memory of this horrible place.